Good evening and welcome to MUFON Los Angeles. My name is Steve Murillo. I am the State Section Director for MUFON LA. We have a very, very interesting program tonight. What if UFO secrecy ended tomorrow? What happens when the powers that be finally admit that we are not alone? How will the truth change our society and your life? Tonight we have a very special guest, Bryce Zabel. He and Richard Dolan co-authored this book, After Disclosure, AD, After Disclosure. I read the book, it's excellent. And it examines many, many different aspects of what's going to happen when finally the truth comes out. Let me tell you a little bit about Bryce. Bryce was the chairman of the TV Academy at one time, and he was responsible for taking the Emmys off the air after 9/11. Do you guys remember that, when 9/11 went and then right after that the Emmys were scheduled? So he was he took the responsibility to take that off the air. I think it was very, very appropriate at the time. Bryce has been a CNN correspondent, an investigative reporter. He also was the creator of a hit TV series in the late 90s called Dark Skies. Has anyone seen that? I know I did. It was a very popular TV series. It took place in the 60s. It was a period piece, but it was very popular. It's now available for sale on DVD. It came out in January, so you guys can purchase that. Bryce co-authored this. He actually got together with Richard Dolan a little bit over a year ago, and it was a brainchild of Bryce's to come up with this book and really examine what happens when the truth comes out. What are the implications to our society? So with that, I'm going to say no more. I'm going to introduce our guest tonight. Please give him a warm welcome, Bryce Zabel.
Welcome. Thank you, Steve. Well, you're about to find out tonight how dangerous it can be when you give a man an iMac. And I kind of went a little crazy. Hopefully, you'll go with me on this ride. I'm trying some stuff out tonight. I thought it would be fun to take a look at. He is right. Dark Skies came out on DVD after a number of years of trying to get it out, and it's now out and beautiful. We don't have any copies to sell, but I am giving one away tonight, giving away a copy of the book and one of the posters that goes with Dark Skies. So we'll have a little trivia and see who wants to win that stuff. But thank you for having me. I've been to MUFON meetings before, and it's always educational, and I have to say, I realize there are a lot of people in this room who know a lot more about this topic than I do. I know certain things about my own side of it, and I'd like to tell you some of that story if I can, and then, hopefully I can learn as much from you guys as you might yourself be exposed to tonight. When we talk about disclosure, though, one of the things that Richard Dolan and I had to try to figure out at the beginning is, what did we mean by disclosure when we talked about it? For our purposes, we kind of came to the conclusion that the real games begin after disclosure, that what leads up to what is called disclosure may not be, by any means, the full story, that even if tomorrow someone in authority were to have to step forward and say, by the way, those things that fly around in the sky, that we don't know exactly what they are, and they have advanced technology, and they're not from here, we don't know that much about them. Well, that would be disclosure, but it wouldn't be full disclosure. We kind of think that there will be probably a limited and a partial disclosure to get us started. And so that's kind of where the book comes from, and we'll be talking more about that tonight. But the one thing I thought is we should take care of the obligatory work first of all, and that means trying to talk about what's in the news. So I thought we'd have a Charlie Sheen slide just to get started. He's, for those of you in the back, he's saying, since we don't need SETI anymore, I wonder if we can use these things to call an escort service. That's from the movie The Arrival, which I think came out in the late 90s also, and Charlie played a SETI scientist who was, of course, shocked to realize that actually we don't have to call them out there because they're already here. And that's something we will be talking about more tonight, about how our scientists have kind of missed the boat on this issue, and especially some of the SETI scientists. So where Rich and I started from was to say there have been 10,000 books that have been written trying to prove that UFOs are real. We did not feel like writing another one. We felt like writing the book that assumes that what you people in this room already know, which is they are real. So the question is, you already know we are not alone. The question is, what happens when they admit it? Some people think that it will be the magic key and that it's going to let us all know everything there is to know, and it will usher in a utopia and a time of peace, prosperity, and wonderful things. Some people, though, like this guy down here, think it will be nail-biting time and a time when we need to be very, very careful. Other people think it will be a spiritual awakening for the entire planet, and it will change life as we know it because it will elevate life as we know it. Some people don't know what to think. It just makes them think that despair will be the proper response to disclosure. Some people think mankind stands on the precipice of gaining incredible, infinite knowledge that these visitors, Rich and I call them the others, that these others will bring to us. And I think that we came to the conclusion that it really all depends on who's behind the curtain. And that's the question. So if we have a disclosure tomorrow that doesn't actually tell us all the details about who is behind the curtain looking at us, then we don't have full disclosure. And really, I think what everyone in this room is probably interested in is some form of full disclosure. Rich and I believe, and I strongly believe, the time is now. I know that going back to the 1950s, people from Donald Kehoe on have been saying, it's just around the corner, it's just around the corner. We believe the issue that was hushed up by one generation and then turned into an object of derision by another now demands to be heard straight up in ours. That's why I'm here tonight. That's why we wrote the book. We have some ideas about bringing that forward. But in general, our take is that it is time to move forward. It is time to use the tools of the trade, of social activism, etc., to make this happen. That talking to ourselves, which we are doing tonight, is good. Better is when we talk to the people who do not already agree with us or do not already have the same degree of knowledge that we might have. So that is what we are about. End UFO secrecy now. We hope that that will become a rallying cry over the course of the next few years, and that those of us in this room will actually live to see some form of disclosure, some form of acknowledgement by people that have inside information and have held it very close to the vest all these years. We hope that those people will be forced or do the right thing, come forward. But in any case, we think UFO secrecy is not something that can just keep on going and keep on going. We're some 70 years nearly into it. We're certainly in our seventh decade of it. Could be a lot longer than that. We're just tired of it. It's time to put an end to it, and I bet I'm speaking for almost everyone here in this room tonight. I want to tell you a little bit about how I came to even be here. I did not start believing anything about UFOs. I started, I read as a kid, I read Interrupted Journey, things like that. But I started as a writer writing this movie here called Official Denial. It was the first original film that was produced for the Sci-Fi Channel. It starred Parker Stevenson, who I actually managed to get to shave his head for the part because he was trying to communicate with one of the Greys, and so he wanted to put it at ease, so he shaved his head. And he did it, so God bless him. What we found out is for $2.5 million, you end up getting a Grey that is a 12-year-old Australian ballerina in a plastic suit. So it was one of the best scripts I've ever written, probably not one of the best movies I've ever had produced. It did, however, in 1993, float I could be wrong, maybe others, maybe it exists prior to that, but the secret of who they are in this film is that they're us. They're time travelers. They're from the future. I worked on Lois and Clark at around the same time, and I got the privilege of giving Clark Kent my birthday. So Superman now is born on my birthday, May 17th, so God bless Superman. And I enjoyed having this opportunity because I said Superman, Kal-El, is an alien. The first episode I wrote was called Strange Visitor from Another Planet. And in that episode, a Majestic 12 kind of organization called Bureau 39 is trying to track down the alien of Superman. And it became
an arc that was in Lois and Clark in the first season. So it kind of, I was kind of getting into this, and I'm doing a little more research, and like a lot of you, I started to realize, wow, you know what? This isn't just a good story, it's a true story. And that kind of freaked me out, and it led to Dark Skies, which went on NBC primetime as part of its trilogy in 1996. And Dark Skies, which we can talk a little bit more about tonight, and I'd love it, if you would watch it, because I'm very proud of it. But it took place in the 1960s, inside Majestic 12. And basically, the pilot episode of Dark Skies has President Kennedy being assassinated because he was going to tell the truth about UFOs and cause disclosure in his second term. Something that my partner Brent Friedman and I made up at the time, we thought, but now people do actually openly speculate about that. But in any case, we felt that it made for a good story, and we basically marched through the 1960s, so it's kind of Mad Men with aliens. I worked on Taken as part of the writing team that helped break the initial stories. Then Spielberg went off to shoot a movie, put it in hibernation. It came back a couple years later. I was on another job, so I didn't take that one across the goal line. But it was fun to work on it. Great to talk to Steven Spielberg about UFOs. That's pretty fun and very interesting, and led me to believe that he's not the insider that people think. He's just a guy that likes alien movies. Last year, I produced a song called Need to Know, the UFO Disclosure Song, which I'm actually going to play for you in a few minutes. But the reason I did it is I felt like we have got to be moving into the social activism part of this thing. It isn't enough to sit in these halls and talk to each other. We have to start to move out. We need an anthem. We need, and I'm not saying that this is the right one, but I'm saying it's one. It's a step in the right direction. It's trying to raise the bar, raise our feelings of empowerment, and to take lessons from the civil rights movement, to take lessons from the Vietnam War protests, and to say, what can we learn? How can we apply some of these changes for ourselves? And out of that came meeting Richard Dolan, who I had not met until about 15 months ago. I optioned his two books, UFOs and the National Security State, in order to turn them into a television series or a series of movies. But while we were working, while I was discussing that with him, first of all, I have to say he's a great guy, and second of all, we just said, you know, we started talking about this idea that I'd had, and he'd had the desire to do the same thing, and we collaborated on that. You can get a copy tonight if you want. It's signed by Richard. All the books that are here are signed by Richard Dolan. I'll sign them as well, and you'll have an autographed copy by both authors if you're interested. And then the final thing that I wanted to talk about in that regard, just to introduce, is Magic Men, which is a movie that I've partnered with, and I'll tell you with who in just a second, but this movie is about the Roswell investigation. It is not about Roswell per se, it is about the investigation that brings Roswell to where it is today, and it will tell the story of Stanton Friedman and Donald Schmidt. So, that's the mystery man. That's my partner I've been blessed with on Magic Men, Don Most, who you remember from Happy Days, and he's here. Don at least waved everybody. He's back there in the... Don and I met during Dark Skies. I cast... we met prior to Dark Skies, and during Dark Skies, I cast Don as Timothy Leary. And to this day, he won't let me forget the bad wig that I made him wear. But he was terrific in the part. We've worked together on another show I did, The Crow, Stairway to Heaven. But we are now partnered because we've, over the years, realized that we have a very shared interest in not only UFOs, but actually trying to figure out ways to get true stories about UFOs before the public. Not just, I'm tired of every time a crazy invasion film comes out, people say, oh, that must mean they're getting us ready for disclosure. You know what? No. Getting us ready for disclosure is talking about the truth. That's going to be the truth. And I just put this slide in because I think it's important. When we talk about Roswell, we all know Roswell. And your friends who don't believe in UFOs probably roll their eyes and go, Roswell, huh? Interesting. You believe in that stuff. tell them that in the same year as Roswell, that the Nathan Twining memo came out, September of 1947, just a few months later, and he said in a memo that came out through the Freedom of Information Act, the phenomenon reported as something real and not visionary or fictitious, and ask them why an Air Force general would be saying that. Ask them. See what their answer is. So, just want to, like I said, I've been blessed with some really excellent partners. That is my partner, Brent Friedman, and we are shooting at the in Washington, D.C. That's where we shot the pilot to Dark Skies. So there's a lot of really, you know, high production value in Dark Skies. It is not like Official Denial. The aliens look pretty good. The sets are great. The acting is fantastic. And like I said, you can get it on DVD right now through Amazon for, I think, $22, which is with free shipping, which is a pretty good deal. We fought for years to get it released because there was a problem with the music rights, because there's such good period music in it that the lawyers said, well, you're going to have to relicense all the music. So it took 13 years. Some people said, well, they're just suppressing your show through the music. I don't know about that, but 13 years after saying that they couldn't release it, lawyers last year said, you know, we looked at the contracts again. You do have the rights to the music. So it's out. Oops. We have a trivia giveaway. So this is the poster that was part of the Dark Skies publicity campaign. It was on buses throughout Los Angeles when it came out, that Shout Factory printed 200 of. So this is a very limited lithograph. And I'm going to give it to someone right now if they can tell me which actor, now deceased, played Captain Frank Bok, the naval intelligence officer who was the leader of Majestic 12. Okay, who said JT first? Come on up. You bet. I was preparing this, and my wife said, well, if you give people something, they're bound to like you. So we're testing that theory. So that's JT. He's now gone, but he was the leader of Majestic 12. He was MJ1 in the series. Okay. I'm testing out the fact that I can play video on this thing, so I'm going to play you the Dark Skies main titles. They're 45 seconds, and I don't know what the sound volume will be. Do we have the sound turned on? Don't want to start it unless you've got it turned on. It's okay? So that's Dark Skies, I'm very proud of it. To the extent that anybody's intrigued, I would love it if you would watch it. All of us who worked on the show worked so hard, and even though it's a work of fiction, we presented a lot of things that you just don't see in television that deal with ufology. The show had characters that range from Bobby Kennedy to Howard Hughes to Carl Sagan, Ronald Reagan, but we also went and did the Betty and Barney Hill story. We also went to Socorro, New Mexico and did the Socorro landing. So we did a lot of UFO things that you people have all, you know, the audience didn't necessarily know about it, but you all do. And I think that you'll find that it rewards your knowledge of ufology. And even though, like I said, it's fictional and there's some crazy stuff that does happen in it, overall, I think you'll really feel rewarded for you'll be treated with intellectual respect. Somebody on the internet did this. It's only 45 seconds, so it's just fun. Somebody took the Dark Skies main titles, which you just saw, which are kind of hyped up, and created Majestic Agent Man, and I don't know, it's just fun.
of a chance he takes. Odds are he won't live to see tomorrow. Secret agent man, secret agent man. They've given you a number and taken away your name.
I just got a kick out of that. Because is my mic off now? Do we have a mic? Okay. Okay? Or no?
Okay. So what I thought was interesting about that, of course, is that if Dark Skies had actually been made in the 1960s instead of just about the 1960s, that's probably what they would have done with it. And then my latest, can you turn that down slightly? My latest partner is Richard Dolan. And Richard is truly, I think, very, very special individual in all of ufology. The man knows what he's doing. He's the best. Okay. Well, it was good at the beginning, it seemed like. Okay. As I said, AD After Disclosure is the work that we collaborated on. I feel extremely lucky, and I feel very fortunate to have worked with him, because I never have had more fun. I guess I had as much fun on Dark Skies, but since Dark Skies, I've done a lot of interesting things that I've enjoyed, but I haven't had as much fun as working with Richard Dolan for basically a year on a book, because I, like many of you, just think he's a terrific writer and he's a profound thinker, and it was my pleasure to work with him on this thing. And I put this up not because I'm trying to do the usual hype about the whole thing, but one of the things that Richard and I told ourselves going into the book is we want the book to be the beginning of a conversation and not the end. We feel that what has to happen, as I said, is we all have to start talking outside of our insular worlds, and we have to start talking to ourselves, and we have to bring our game up. So we've created the website afterdisclosure.com, and we have a Facebook presence, because we don't want the book to be the end, we want the book to be the beginning. Just as Disclosure, whatever it is not the end of the process, it's the beginning of the process, we feel the same way. And one of the things that we've done is we've tried to bring a higher level of writing on the UFO topic to our website. So in addition to the book, which we have, I've written some and Richard's written some that have just phenomenal reach. He just wrote this one about how the change in Egypt has certain amounts of application to where we are right now with the disclosure movement. We wrote about seeing the future in the past and how the whole ancient astronaut area and the interest in the public is something that we can grab hold of right now as we want to try to bring disclosure. We weighed in on the whole nuclear missile and UFO issue. Because that was obviously a pretty big deal in September when there was the National Press Club news conference. And Rich wrote a brilliant article called Facts Still Matter, because one of the reasons we're not treated so credibly is just how we deal with ourselves and with other people on the internet sometimes, and how we run off saying things are facts before they're facts. And Rich was very strong on saying, facts do matter. It's important to get them right, especially if we're going to be trying to tell people who don't believe that UFOs are real, that they are real, then we better get our facts together. So for example, when people were going on about Project Blue Beam and how that was going to change the world a month ago or in October or whenever it was, we tried to take a point of view. No, that's not happening. When NASA said that they were going to disclose some big new revelation about life on other planets, and then they told us that there was a little bug in the Mono Lake that had arsenic in it, we said, that's great that you found that, but why aren't you looking at the skies? That's your job.
we took the event to task for having an entire storyline supposedly about aliens that pretends that all of ufology never existed. There's a show that's in an alternative universe. And we even tried to reach out and have fun by asking people who they thought would be the, you know, the best person to help bring UFO knowledge to the public, whether it would be Jon Stewart or Colbert, because Colbert had just interviewed Leslie Kane. And we weighed in on the Robert Salas case because there's one man in particular who's been accusing him of making it all up. And Rich wrote a very, very detailed article about it. And that's not in our book, it's on the website. And even for Thanksgiving, we tried to write an essay about how Thanksgiving was a cautionary tale about contact between a so-called superior technological civilization and a native civilization. So we're trying to bring the game up, bring it to the people, get it out there, get people talking on a slightly different level. So I want to show you the concept trailer that we put out for AD. This is the thing that's been on YouTube. And I want to show it to you for two reasons. One, it raises some of the issues that are in the book and answered in the book as questions. The other thing is it's the song called Need to Know, the UFO Disclosure song, which is performed by Cherish Alexander, who is a Los Angeles musician, an incredibly talented woman, who I used on the Crow Stairway to Heaven as one of our top people in the music department. So I'm going to play this now, so if we need to adjust the volume, hopefully we can do that. Seems good.
Friend or foe, tell me now. You need to know. mystery solved. There should be lights, just a lost weather balloon. An Air Force spokesman confirms tonight that this was no flying saucer. Sports is next.
Just being well, the Air Force says, in a way, lights in the sky and on fire.
Thank you. I hope other people follow suit. I hope more songs like that come out. But, you know, when it just struck me last year that there wasn't a good song, there just wasn't anything. It sounded a little funky from where I was back here, the mix and so forth. But it is on iTunes. Cherish Alexander is the artist. And you know, it's 99 cents, I guess. But we're thrilled to be able to do it, and it just speaks from my heart. It's like what I think we need to say to people. We need to know. And now is the time. As I said, now is the time. So, let's get into some disclosure stuff. Let's talk about Earth after disclosure. And when Rich and I had our wonderful discussions with each other, we chased our tails around every which way. We looked at it inside, outside, and from the top and the bottom, and we came to the conclusion, as you'll see in our book, that it really is the good, the bad, and the ugly. There are positives, there are negatives, and there are things that are difficult to get your arms around. It's probably, as people have always said, it is the issue of our age, and it is one that we need to get on with. We clearly have come to the conclusion: it doesn't matter what the full truth really is. We think you've got to just trust the 7 billion people on the planet to deal with it, not just a small elite group of people that get to manage the issue. So it's time to move on. So let's take some of the issues that people have talked about. Panic in the streets. This goes back to 1938. This may, in fact, be one of the reasons why the secret keepers after Roswell and during the 40s decided to keep this secret. They saw what they discerned to be panic in the streets following the Orson Welles broadcast of The War of the Worlds. And there were people that were freaking out. There's no question. There were some people who were freaking out. It's also entered mythology. It wasn't necessarily quite as bad as people have said. But the question you really have to ask yourself is, would disclosure, first of all, that isn't disclosure. If that was their reason not to disclose, that's about Martians have landed in New Jersey and they're blowing the crap out of everybody. Well, I'd panic in the streets too. But if the truth that is ultimately revealed is not that they're blowing us up, but they're here and they're doing other things, then we'll probably be able to handle it. Plus, society's been through a few things since 1938 that we're a little more grown up about some of that stuff. But one of the things that Rich and I did in this book, and I'm very proud that we had the guts to just go ahead and do it, is, look, you may disagree. You may read our book and you may say, I don't agree with everything. That's great. You know why? Because that's the discussion we want to have happen. We feel it's time for people to start having these arguments and these debates. So what we really tried to do is say, what might happen? How might this really lay down? What might really happen? So we think, for example, that AD, the reason we picked AD is whether someone actually calls it AD or not, from the moment that the words are uttered, that we are not alone, from an official, from someone who is in power, that's when the clock starts again. That's when the calendar restarts. That's when we reboot society. It's disclosure day. It's day one. How will it go down? Well, it might go down like that. One of the things we thought is there will be no single incident. It will be an avalanche of incidents. It might be a mass sighting, very well recorded, radar, visual, all the stuff that we've seen happen before and that MUFON has brilliantly recorded, but it may be followed by a deathbed confession. It may be a WikiLeaks that goes with it. There'll be some constellation of events where a president or someone will say, what the hell is going on here? And we'll get some facts and we'll lay some version of the facts out. Again, I don't necessarily believe in full disclosure being forthcoming immediately. I even think, personally, that the disclosure plan, such as it exists, would be to do limited disclosure and make the system, the law, the Congress, and everyone else drag the full truth out kicking and screaming over a year or several years period, because that gives more time for people to get in the swing of things. So it's hard to say. I didn't write that plan. I've never laid my eyes on the plan that people have, but there is a plan someplace. You can guarantee that. Somebody wrote a plan, and it may start like that.
What would limited disclosure be like?
Well, we'll go back to that first. Limited disclosure would simply be, for example, let's say that the truth, I don't presume to know the truth, but let's say the truth involved multiple entities visiting from various configurations, space, dimension, whatever. And it's complicated and it's messy and there's stuff that is uncomfortable to talk about. Limited disclosure might be saying, yeah, well, by the way, Roswell was real. You've heard about that. Yeah, we're going to cop to that. That happened. And yeah, we saw some bodies. We saw that. And yeah, they're from, pick a planet, they're from Zeta Reticuli. But most of the stuff that you've seen have been our saucers. So don't anybody freak out. That's all we really know. That would be limited disclosure, right? That would be dipping your toe in the water and waiting for the next thing to happen, as opposed to full disclosure, where you basically call the press in like that and you say, and by the way, there's a hard drive waiting for you in the room outside that has 50,000 photos and 300 hours of gun camera video and every document that was ever written, et cetera, et cetera. That's full disclosure. I don't think full disclosure is going to happen. I think even if someone wanted to have full disclosure, they'd have to figure out, we can't have full disclosure right away because we can't clear all these documents in time to even get them. It would leak while we were trying to get full disclosure prepared. So I don't think it'll be full. But I do think no matter what they say, there are certain things we can believe that are going to happen on day one. Hoarding will happen. There won't be a store anywhere with full shelves. Why do we know that? That's how we deal with things. If a blizzard is coming, we go buy everything in sight. If somebody has an earthquake, even in another part of the world, we go buy stuff. We buy earthquake supplies. The minute anybody says we're not alone, people are going to buy stuff. That's not necessarily bad. It's just human reaction. But what it's going to do is it's going to create a dynamic that is kind of interesting, which is it isn't necessarily the idea that somebody else is here. It's going to be our own reaction to that news that is going to cause, if there's panic in the streets, it may be caused by that as much as anything, because hoarding will happen, will lead to looting, which will lead to, in some places, martial law. Not forever, but at least in some places. And what we tend to think about martial law is that short term you're going to see some of it for sure, but the people will be a greater threat than any aliens, at least at the beginning. We're going to be doing our own damage. And the cure, putting martial law is as bad as the disease, for obvious reasons, because it's only going to make people more paranoid. And the minute that you acknowledge that there is a reality here, you instantly have people knowing the government's been lying for a long time. So the government that's been lying, you hardly want declaring martial law and throwing you in jail. So there are problems that are not necessarily extraterrestrial, but are simply human. So let's go through some of these things. Let's go back. Whoa, I'm totally messed up here. Sorry, I told you it was a new toy. There we go. The economy will, again, you're welcome to disagree, but we predict that disclosure, if it happened officially in the United States, would happen on a Friday at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, because the banks will be closing and the stock market will be closed on the East Coast. And it won't give the media time to try to figure out how to spend all day interviewing everybody. and they will have the weekend to see how people are dealing with the news before they have to do anything on Monday. And we think the stock market, we tried to do a lot of our thinking by interpreting what has happened in the past. So we thought, for example, that they're going to close the stock market. We did after 9/11. Why wouldn't we do it after disclosure? We'll close the stock market. We've had bank holidays. Roosevelt did it. We'll probably have a bank holiday because we'll want to keep these economic nerves from completely sending the economy into a complete dumper. So for a while, there's going to be a crisis of confidence. And you know, people respond in different ways to undecided events, but this will be the granddaddy of all undecided events. It is inevitable there will be economic dislocation. But again, remember, we came back from 9/11. We can come back from disclosure. Moving ahead, though, by week one, after, and I'm shortening things that in the book we go into a lot more detail, but by week one, we will all realize disclosure is not the end of the process, but just the beginning. On day one of disclosure, a lot of people are going to think, well, that's it, okay, all right. You know, and then the questions will start coming, and the answers won't be very good. And there'll be people demanding better answers. So we kind of mocked up a Newsweek magazine here of the idea that what we're trying to get across is the same process that happens for everything will continue to be followed. Day one, yeah, there'll be a news conference in the Oval Office. Week one, yeah, there'll be a Newsweek magazine trying to interpret what's going on. That kind of stuff isn't going to change. But a lot of other things are, for obvious reasons. But you're going to see, when you realize that disclosure is not the end and you haven't had full, complete disclosure, that's when this slide kicks in, when you start to say, wait a minute, though there's language, there's aliens, there's flying saucers, what do you guys know? And when did you know it? The old Watergate thing. What did you know? When did you know it? And the question is really going to resonate throughout the entire world, because disclosure is not something that will happen only in the United States, and it may not be started by the United States. Disclosure may happen, for example, because the United States, we may decide to get in front of the story. We may hear that Brazil or China is going to disclose in some way, and we don't want to cede that ground to them, so we may do it ourselves. We may beat them to the punch, and we may not be prepared. I was talking to Don on the way in, and I was just saying one of the things that Rich and I kicked around was, if you want a metaphor for disclosure, think about Iraq. When we went into Iraq, the people who you said were in charge and ought to know better were surprised that people were looting, and they didn't have a plan. We were surprised by IEDs. We didn't have a plan. People died. It got messy. Eventually, after 6 years, we started to be smarter about IEDs. We started to be smarter about the country that we were in, and we began to make changes. Well, we're going to have to do that. It's going to be a little messy at the beginning, and no amount the government will not be as prepared as we would like them to be. They're just not going to be. They weren't prepared for Iraq. They should have been. They won't be prepared for disclosure. So what's going to happen at the government level is we're going to see truth commissions. We're going to see congressional investigations immediately. Congressmen who wouldn't give UFOs the time of day are suddenly going to be saying, who are they? What do they want? You know, what did you know? When did you know it? You're going to see that kind of stuff, people falling all over themselves to get in front of TV cameras. And we're going to follow what we think happened in South Africa, which was the truth commissions. We think there will be truth commissions. And we think probably one of the big issues that's going to come up is, are we going to arrest people that were part of the cover-up? Are we putting them in jail? And right around the time when we start to think seriously about putting them in jail, the president is probably going to pardon them. And the president is going to pardon them because the president pardoned Jimmy Carter pardoned draft resistors. Presidents have the power of pardon. Gerald Ford pardoned Richard Nixon. Not because Richard Nixon was a good guy. He pardoned Richard Nixon because he wanted the country to move on, he said. So some president is going to say, this disclosure mess is really not working out the way it ought to, and we've got to move on. So in order to get the truth out and to get people to tell what they know, he'll probably issue some kind of pardon that will apply to the cover-up, but probably not to felonies, probably not to murder, you know, not to treason, but to following orders to keep the secret. And I put that up there because it's time for another trivia giveaway. And this time you get a Dark Skies DVD set. Who said that? And you haven't even seen it. The man gets it, but now you guys get to watch it first. This is, and this will come in, this is the breakaway group. This is a meeting of Majestic 12 and Dark Skies.
The mission has to change from observation to confrontation. To that end, we need money, and our current budget isn't adequate.
$200 million buys a lot of confrontation, Frank.
That's for 1 year, Nate. I'm talking about $1 billion over 5 years.
A billion.
We can't skim that much from the defense budget.
We're working on it right now.
Vietnam?
That's for another meeting.
That's what you said about President Kennedy's assassination, and I'm sick of being kept in the dark.
Just exactly what do you mean by that, Hubert?
Meaning everyone in this room has heard rumors about a conspiracy.
JFK was told about us before his death.
I was at a fundraiser last weekend for LBJ. I heard Majestic mentioned in the same breath as Oswald.
No, I had that check, Bill, and the CIA knows we're completely clean.
The CIA thought the Bay of Pigs was a good idea, too.
I don't give a damn what they say at cocktail parties. Alan, you're in the Warren Commission. Is Majestic under any suspicion whatsoever?
No, they're completely focused on that sick communist Oswald.
Perception, not reality. If we don't get this under control now, Majestic's going to be common knowledge by the end of the century.
Just answer the question, Frank. Was Majestic involved or not?
Hubert, Kennedy had a lot of enemies. And I'm not going to say that we didn't have our problems, but on this question, I can assure you Majestic is clean, period. Excuse me.
So that was Art Bell playing William S. Paley on the Majestic 12 board, which I thought was probably the greatest act of subversion I've ever accomplished with network television. Yes, it was Art, our man Art, and... And by the way, it was amazing to call Art. I've been on his show in during the promotion of the series, and I just thought, how crazy would it be to make the president of CBS, Art Bell, talking about the Kennedy assassination on Majestic 12? So I got my dream. Okay. The media is going to come in for a lot of criticism. Do you remember this... cover of Newsweek magazine with the pictures from McMinnville? Of course not. I faked that one too. You know why? The media doesn't cover flying saucers. They don't believe in flying saucers. They didn't believe in them back then. That's the Newsweek from the week that they would have probably written about it. And I had to doctor it up because they had some nonsense on about something that wasn't very important. And the truth is, In the entire time that Newsweek and Time have been publishing, I believe Newsweek did one cover about Steven Spielberg, and Time did one cover on the 50th anniversary of Roswell, where they made fun of everybody. So you also never saw this Time magazine, which you should have seen last year. We covered it on our website. It was the 60th anniversary of those McMinnville photos. After all these years, they haven't been explained, but would you find an article, let alone a cover story, in any of the national media? Of course not, because it doesn't exist. It's not true. And they're smarter than you and me. And I know what that's like. I used to be a CNN correspondent. I know what those people are like. I was one of them. And they think they're smarter. And they also think it's like high school. All right. Remember in high school, you're deathly afraid that you'll look silly. Right? You cannot let that happen. That is the most important thing. It trumps everything. Well, these are the cool kids, and they don't want to look stupid, so they don't believe in flying saucers. So, this is one thing we did. One of the tactics we believe should be, we should start embarrassing the media. When they screw up, we should make fun of them. John Kelly was sent by Washington Post to cover the news conference in September, where six Air Force officers spoke about nuclear weapons and UFOs at the National Press Club. And John Kelly, who covers lifestyle issues in a humor column for the Washington Post, was sent down to cover those men. And John Kelly wrote a lead paragraph about the cookies that he liked at the press club and concluded his story with another observation about the cookies. We got into a little bit of a fracas with Mr. Kelly. We called him on it, we printed it, we humiliated him, we did everything we could. We just said, you know what, you want to create nonsense, then you don't want to look silly, we're going to make you look silly. We're going to make fun of you. So we made fun of him. And we pointed out the fact that these guys were military officers. All right, is he saying that they're lying? If so, that's a story. Maybe the Washington Post should cover that. Why would military officers lie? That's an interesting story, but they don't cover that either. It doesn't make any sense. And yet, that's how they did it. I'm going to show you a slide later on about what we did to Mr. Kelly, but we'll hold that in suspense for a moment. But the media, I think, is going to have to embrace what I call ultimate transparency. After disclosure, the media is going to realize that for 70 years, they completely missed out on this thing, that they did not cover the story properly. All right? And because of that, somebody in the media is going to say, there's no reason for the public to trust us. And they're going to have to come up with a new policy. Now, one of the things that I believe about the media is that they will be a huge loser after disclosure. After disclosure, there will be winners and there will be losers. The media will be one of the largest losers by far. But they can't go out of existence. So because even though they're a loser, they're going to be a winner because they're still going to get to cover their own mistakes. And guess what? That's what they're going to do. That's what ultimate transparency is going to be. The media is going to cover their own decision-making about disclosure. They're going to put themselves on camera. And they're going to try to gain back the trust of the people. And they're going to hope that we all have very short memories and we don't remember what screw-ups they were and how they looked down at us and all these things. And they're going to try to cover themselves doing the right thing. And they're going to pat themselves on the back for their great exposés of Air Force bases and their crusades to gain more disclosure. And we'll probably let them get away with it because we're going to be fixed to the television sets. So, big loser, but still a winner. That's one of the things that I'm doing, which unites my partnership with Brent Friedman with my partnership with Richard Dolan. Brent's company, Electric Farm Entertainment, and my company, Stellar Productions, have joined forces to develop After Disclosure into a television series. And I don't want to get into too much about what it is, but it will be entering into the story of disclosure from the point of view of the media. Because I generally don't like media stories, but I think media is where the action is in terms of being able to see the big picture of disclosure because they're such screw-ups and because we'll all be watching TV. So hopefully look for that in the future. But another loser that's a winner is the military. Why are they a loser? Well, they're a loser because they participated in the cover-up all these years. At the beginning, for sure, they participated extremely in detail in the cover-up. Richard and I tend to believe the cover-up is now a managed situation between public and private sources, but clearly the military is going to have to do a real two-step here because they're going to say, look, we admit that we were part of this cover-up and you're probably pretty upset about that. On the other hand, you're probably also scared, well, we're here to help. So the military will instantly go to DEFCON 1 on the day after disclosure, or the day of disclosure. The militaries worldwide will be standing up everywhere. Every police officer in the world and every armed forces personnel in the world will be on duty the day of disclosure and probably for the week after. And they will be doing threat assessment. Some of them know something, some of them don't know anything. They're all going to be trying to figure out what the threat level is. And you will see unprecedented talks between various militaries of the various governments of the world as they discuss whether they can pool any military assets and try to ask each other, well, what do you know? Because no one's going to want to, just because there's disclosure on a large level doesn't mean that it's across the board and that everyone's playing the game. So look for a very, very high level of military preparedness immediately after disclosure. So The one thing they taught me as a journalist, I went to University of Oregon's School of Journalism, and they said, you know, you want to be able to tell people, are they safe, right? Well, that's the question. Who are they? Okay, who are these others? Who are they? Is someone going to come forward and just lay it all out? I don't think so. I think this is one of the things that will have to be pried out bit by bit. These are some of the theories. Extraterrestrials been the hardy standby all these years. People talk about extra-dimensional. Lost Earth civilization has a few adherents here and there. Intelligent machines is getting a lot of traction, more and more people talking about that. Angels and demons, talk to the evangelical community, and you'll find out that many people in the evangelical community know more about UFOs than you do. They just don't think they're extraterrestrial. Time travelers, which would make me a very popular guy, having predicted it in 1993. And something else to be determined. Don't really know. The question is, though, what do they want? Whoever they are, what do they want? And that's going to be the big question that is going to continue to chip away at whatever limited disclosure there's been and pry it a little bit further open, because people are going to want to know, they're going to, whatever they are told initially, they're going to say there's got to be more to the story. And they're going to know, what do you know about this? Do you know about any of that? And look, I'm talking to a crowd that knows a whole lot. You people are extremely wise on this. You all have your own theories. You know a lot of different things. But there doesn't appear to be consensus at this point about anything other than there's probably more than one type. There's multiple types out there. And the Earth, instead of being, Stanton Friedman's a friend of mine, but he always says, why would anybody be interested? You know, he always makes the argument, well, you know, why are they, you know, they why would they be interested in us? We're just this backwater, you know, planet in the middle of nowhere. And the truth is, I think that when the truth is out, there's something very, very, very interesting about the Earth, and there's something very, very interesting about humans. And I'm not sure what it is, but you may have other theories. But the one thing that we found in doing our research is, people assume that religion is going to crater, that people are going to lose their faith, and, you know, literally all hell will break loose. We didn't find that. It depends, of course, what disclosure is. I mean, if it's really, really bad or really, really twisted, then I guess it will affect everybody. But what we found instead is that when there have been numerous studies of this, and the people who predict that religious people will freak out are atheists and agnostics. Religious people, generally speaking, do not predict they'll freak out in large numbers. Most of them seem to accept the position that, well, it just means God's flock is a little bigger. Certainly the Catholic Church is leaning in the direction very heavily of disclosure right now. Maybe they know something. They have a lot of observatories. They might. But the truth that we found is that, at least in the abstract, if you ask a religious person what they are going to do if there is disclosure of intelligent non-human life forms, and they're like, well, okay. They are not as freaked out about it as people think. So that'll probably be okay. We're back to SETI. That's from Contact, which is Carl Sagan's big movie. And she's saying, now that they've disclosed UFOs, this job doesn't seem half as cool as it used to be. Because, let's face it, if anyone's going to be a loser in disclosure, it's got to be those people that have hung on so heavy to SETI and said that that's what it's all about, when they've missed the very truth that's flying around in the skies of their own planet. That's going to look pretty silly, including, you know, Carl Sagan. Carl Sagan is going to find in his death that his reputation isn't what it used to be. I have a little bit of history with Carl Sagan. I interviewed him when Voyager was coming, doing its Close Encounter with Saturn, and I interviewed him live on PBS. And I talked to him in the parking lot, and I said, I just don't understand how you could say that there are civilizations that are hundreds of thousands of years ahead of us, but that they can't possibly be here. You've just said that they're, you know, you say the universe is teeming with life, but they can't be here. That doesn't seem rational. And A lot of people think that Carl Sagan knew more than he ever let on and that he was in somebody's pocket. And literally in the last two episodes of Dark Skies, which you'll get to see, Carl Sagan is a character, and he is given the opportunity to either work for Majestic and be told the whole truth, or to maintain his independence and learn nothing. And he goes to work for Majestic. But clearly, science is going to have egg on its face. I mean, they have not detected what's going on, and even those who have don't talk about it. Lots of scientists have UFO books in their basements, but they don't talk about it. Uh-oh, trivia giveaway. What was the name of the 1961 report which concluded that scientists and engineers would be the most shocked by the discovery of intelligent... Somebody said it first. Did you say it first? There it is, the Brookings Report. Here's a copy of AD, and I'll sign it for you afterwards. All right? Well, I got to tell my wife this is working out so well. So it's the Brookings Report, and I thought it was very prescient of them in 1961 to say that scientists would be among those most rattled, because they've got a lot invested in establishment science. And I wanted to bring my partner, Richard Dolan, to life here. He talks about how we're leaping into their world, and I thought it said a lot. It's just a short clip from one of our presentations. Uh-oh. Can we have some audio there? Thank you.
We are not standing still here. A mere 100 years ago, we had a society of horses pulling carts. We go from that to radios, cars, airplanes, atomic bombs, computers, guided missiles, artificially intelligent computers. We're moving into a world of nanotech, advanced biotech, interpersonal communications that are going off the charts. What is our world going to look like in 10 years, in 20 years, in 50 years? Do we honestly think we're going to be looking exactly the same as we do today? No. There are other people, other beings, other intelligences that have been observing us for a long time.
So, what Richard, I loved how he states it. He goes on to say that we are leaping into their world, so they're going to pay attention to us. And I think that he's got a good point there. 50 years ago, when Donald Kehoe was predicting imminent disclosure, he was guilty of wishful thinking, and also it was an early time, and people were not vested into the cover-up as they are now. It may very well be that disclosure, there, I think, and as we lay it out in the book, there's like 10 or 20 ways that could lead to disclosure. But one way that Richard points out is we will disclose them to ourselves. Screw the secret keepers, you know? We'll just operate on a different track. When it comes time to disclose, we'll figure it out. And I think that that's happening. So we're in a race right now between our increasing abilities to discern the world around us, as Richard pointed out, and the idea that somebody official has to tell us what's going on. It may not have to be that way. We may figure it out in a way that is public and that it can't be denied. So, when it comes to science, I don't know why I came up. Lucy, you got some splaining to do. Science has a lot to answer for, but again, big, big loser, big, big winner at the same time, because now they get to, they're going to be challenged by this new information about what these others are and what their agenda is with us in the worlds of biology and genetics and disease prevention. And let's face it, if people's memories are being wiped, what does that tell us about consciousness and memory? Are we wiping memories? Are the others wiping memories? What is a memory? What is consciousness? We're going to have some new research on that. Gravity. Well, obviously somebody is, they're not flying these things around on gasoline. So something about gravity is not quite the way we think it is. And there's probably some version of a unified field theory that's going to bring science together and at the same time unleash a different kind of energy which will change the game. It will change us from an oil-based economy to something else, whatever it is. And science better get cracking. If there is a moment of disclosure when we say, by the way, these things are flying around, they're advanced technology, they're not ours, they're from someplace that's not here. Well, even if we learn nothing more than that, if that's all they told us, then scientists better get to work. Because if they're not ours and they're somebody else's, then somebody's got better stuff than we have and we better get on it. From an education point of view, I mean, we devote a whole chapter to this. You better just start rewriting all the books. Dark Skies rewrote the history books. We said history is a lie. There's going to be all kinds of historical events. But what about archaeology going back? Were there ancient astronauts? How's that going to be interpreted now? Anthropology. What if someone determines that there's a similar piece of DNA in a human? What's that going to do to society? What are we going to do about all those things? You're going to see academia go crazy researching things, and not necessarily extraterrestrial things, cover-up things. There's been a breakaway group that has figured out how to manage the secret for 60-some years. How were they funded? I can only imagine economics majors getting to work on trying to figure out how that funding occurred. So, and how were they managed? Political science majors will be getting into that. More papers are going to be published in the decade after disclosure than at any time in human history. So we have another one of our comics where the kid says, I wonder why the teacher at school never told us about this. Because the teacher didn't believe and the teacher didn't know, but the teacher will believe and the teacher will know. And teachers, after disclosure, are going to be going into their classrooms and saying to themselves, I feel like I'm a student. I don't know what to tell these kids. We're all in this together. And that's going to be a fascinating, fascinating time. And the one thing we know also about law, if you think about human society right now, everything we do ends up in court. Why will disclosure be different? It won't. Everything will end up in court. What about an airline pilot, for example? What about that? What about an airline pilot that reported a UFO encounter and found that he was grounded for 3 years? You think he's not going to sue somebody after disclosure? So it's going to end up in court. Take a look at all these concepts. Every single one of them has a legal remedy or a legal aspect to it. You know, need to know and secrecy. That's going to end up in court. Everything ends up in court. And the court, we're going to see Supreme Court battles about secrecy. We're going to see, there's going to be people, there'll probably be abductee groups who file group lawsuits against somebody for not helping them more. You're going to see all kinds of that kind of thing. You're going to see, right now there's an entire area of aviation law, which we talk about in the book. And that whole aviation law, they will try to apply to others. But how do you sue another? Can you? Well, probably not. I mean, they'd have to acknowledge that you're right to sue them. They probably won't do that. But that doesn't mean that you can't collect a judgment. Ask any lawyer. There'll be lawyers, you know, out on the street corner handing out business cards to people trying to sue somebody over disclosure. No, that's true. So, one of the most fascinating chapters for us was just trying to think about culture. And the one thing that I would actually say, it's harder to predict culture than it is what happens in science and education and religion, etc., even though those are fascinating and infinite in the ways that they can change. But culture has an energy of its own. So we tried to go, well, what's the best metaphor for the culture change that we're in? We think it's the 60s. The death of Kennedy and the Vietnam War provided an impetus for people to distrust the government and to question authority. Well, there's nothing that's going to cause you to question authority more than disclosure. You're going to say, wait a minute, let me get this straight. You guys knew this and you didn't tell us, and you did this and you did that. The more that's going to come out, you're going to see all kinds of actions. And you're going to see some people becoming more political. You're going to see some people dropping out. You're going to see experimentation with drugs by people that never did those things before. All kinds of parallels will come about. There'll be a few parallels to the 50s. If it's possible that some of these others might walk among us, watch out for the new McCarthyism. There's all kinds of possibilities about what might happen, but the 60s struck us as a really positive image, that society will be on fire. It'll be on fire everywhere. It'll be on, and I don't mean literally on fire, I mean intellectually on fire. Everybody will be trying to make sense of it. Artists, for example, will, you know, anyone who has a creative bone or an iMac is going to go nuts trying to come up with a way to express their feelings about what's happening to our world. So the culture will blow up. Not necessarily in a bad way, but it's going to go places that you can't even begin to predict. There's only one prediction I am willing to make about our culture, and that is within 2 weeks of Disclosure, Bruce Springsteen will have a new song. And it's going to be great. And again, as you begin to think about, well, what's going to happen after Disclosure, that's one way to think about it. You know, things that have happened before, you know, people that respond, he responded to the 9/11 attacks with The Rising. Well, he probably responded to Disclosure with something. How could he not? He's an artist. So certain things like that are going to happen. Comedians will still make jokes. Nightclubs will still pack people in, but they'll be talking about Disclosure and they'll be talking about the others. And who better to predict that the 60s would come back than our friend John Lennon? He wrote, or said in an interview, "If the masses started to accept UFOs, it would profoundly affect their attitudes toward life, politics, everything. It would threaten the status quo. Whenever people come to realize that there are larger considerations than their own petty little lives, they are ripe to make radical changes on a personal level, which would eventually lead to a political revolution in society as a whole." John Lennon. And I think that he's right. I think he, by the way, saw a UFO, as you all know, in the 70s, about 100 yards away from him in New York. And he was courageous enough to report it, but given his drug use and the fact that he was stark naked when he saw it, people didn't give him a lot of credit. But I've talked to people who said the fact that John Lennon talked about his sighting and was willing to be that outspoken about it caused them to have an open mind, you know, about things. So he is an example of the emotional way in we have to start taking to get, we need to have rooms that are like this, that are stadiums full of people listening to these topics. We need to change the dynamic. He's one way in. All right, AD year one, which we have dubbed the year of living dangerously. It ain't going to be pretty, but it will be fascinating and interesting. It's like you folks have all remember Dr. Strangelove and General Buck Turgidson, I believe, is talking about surviving a nuclear war. And he says, "I ain't saying we're not going to get our hair mussed." And that's what we think, you know. It's going to be, our hair's going to get mussed up pretty big because of the things that we're going to do in reaction to this knowledge. But it will be the most fascinating, alive, crazy, interesting, phenomenal time in history. But the same things that happen now will keep happening then. On the one-year anniversary, they'll put a stamp out. All right? Things will continue to follow form. There may be disruptions. There'll be political revolutions. There'll be political party shifts. Like, for example, I'm not necessarily predicting this, but I'm saying that clearly one party is going to take the Ronald Reagan point of view of trust but verify, and another party will probably take the position of, let's dialogue and reach out. That might be the Republicans and the Democrats, or it might be fringe groups of either party. New parties will probably be created, but the form and function of the fact that there's still politics, human politics to be practiced, will continue. The United Nations probably will fall apart. It will be seen to be irrelevant, even though people think, well, this is the perfect job for the United Nations. We actually think opposite. We think the United Nations will be rendered impotent by this news and be unable to respond properly. And some of the larger governments will come together and try to put together some kind of planetary alliance that can be responsive. In our book, we speculate it might be Brazil, but it could be anybody. So, just for fun, when we talk about form and function being the same, people will still poll people. There'll still be public opinion polls. So we created our own little public opinion poll, Stellar Opinion Dynamics Abstract, Emerging Views After Disclosure. And the question asked is, since the public disclosure of the presence of extraterrestrial life here on Earth, describe your level of confidence in the United States government to handle the matter correctly. Now, again, people in the know are all going to disagree. None of you will agree with what I'm about to show you, but it's just an opinion. It was just something that we were playing around with. At AD plus 1 week, the number of people who are confident the government might handle it is about 39%. The number of people who aren't sure is 31%, and the number of people who are extremely skeptical is 30%. Not too bad for the government in the first week, because I think at this point people are really looking for answers, and they haven't quite figured out just how badly they've been lied to. So what we think will happen is, you know, and by the way, again, we're just making this, I mean, we don't have a crystal ball, but what we think might be interesting, at the very beginning, the undecideds are going to be as large as any other group. Now, you go out a year, we think after you take a year of bad news and lies and deceit, unraveling and truth commissions and everything that you can possibly imagine, the number of people who are extremely confident has fallen to only a quarter. The number of people who aren't sure, there's a lot fewer of them because they're starting to take sides and they're all going over to the skeptical and extremely skeptical side by a year out. So you've got now a 60% majority saying, I don't think they're handling it very well a year out. Now, Richard and I are optimists. We think society sorts things out. So we think if you go out 10 years, same question, you have a lot more people who are confident. If, in an optimistic scenario, the government reforms itself and begins to level with people and try to get clean. If it does that, it can have numbers like that. If it stonewalls fights and must be kicked and dragged and beat up to get the truth out, then obviously that wouldn't happen. That's the optimistic scenario. And I want to just give Richard one other time to speak here, because he talks about optimism here, and like I said, we're both optimists. Okay. What do we have to do to get... Okay. Okay. All right.
Do that.
There's going to be a blowback that is beyond belief. 60-plus years of institutionalized lying, deception by our political leaders, by the media, which has worked hand in glove with them. This is not going to be clean. It's going to be messy. And how bad that goes is not something that I can really see with my own crystal ball. But I remain an optimist. Part of it is a crazy faith in this idea called truth. I mean, that's something that I can't really justify to you, but I believe in the power and in the value of truth. And I do believe that we as a species are going to prove mature enough. And when we wake up to the fact that our world is totally different than what we thought, that we will find a way to deal with it. In that sense, I'm a strong optimist for the future of our species, our civilization.
I couldn't have said it better, so I let him say it. That's how I feel. And I know that there's a lot of reason for pessimism in this case, because this very important topic has been denied the truth. And those of us in this room know it, and yet we live in a world that denies it, where our friends and our family members think we're kind of like the crazy uncle at the party. You know, we're the drunks that don't know what's going on. But the truth is, you do know what's going on. So it's easy to be angry and pessimistic, but we just think it's going to sort itself out, that when the truth is pulled out over the course of disclosure, in that period, there'll be social disruption, yes. I haven't even really spoken really about the agenda of the others, whatever their agenda is, might be bad, might be good, might be mixed. Whatever it is, we're going to deal with it. And that's what we do. We're humans. We're very adaptable. We've adapted to horrific things and wonderful things, and we keep moving forward, and we'll probably do it again. So, I started by saying, you know we are not alone. The question we ask at the beginning is, was what? You know we are not alone. What happens when they finally tell us the truth? But I think there's a different question. You know we are not alone. What are you going to do about it? Are you going to be that guy? Are your neighbors going to be that guy? Will that help? I don't think so. Some people will reach out through our social networking. That's certainly one way that we can start to change this dialogue. But remember, when you just pass around ideas that, you know, poorly punctuated, badly thought out ideas don't necessarily make people believe that you've got the pipeline to some truth. So bring the game up, play in the social network, but bring the game up. Be the people that they want to hear the truth from. It may lead to rallies. We may need to start finding ways to get out of these rooms with 50 people and into larger venues with hundreds of thousands of people. We may need to figure out how to turn this into an electoral issue so that we can compel different behavior from people. And that's going to be a tough one, because right now if you try to turn it into an electoral issue, you get laughed at. We've all seen the YouTube of Obama even being asked about it, saying, I'm more concerned about what's going on here. Okay, it's very hard. You saw how Kucinich was ridiculed for his sighting. So it's going to be hard, but that's something that we can think about. I think that is the number one thing that we should do. I bet you all have a lot of friends who you talk to who believe as you do, and it's fun to talk to them. Don and I enjoy our conversations, but we both believe the same thing. My wife doesn't believe what I believe. I have friends who don't believe what I believe. And I think the courage is to talk to those people and tell them what you believe and why you believe it. Offer them a book to read. Talk to them about why you believe what you believe. And don't be afraid to show it, okay? We need to put it on the public mind. We need to say UFO secrecy exists and we want it ended. We have to start saying this to people besides ourselves. And when people go, what are you talking about? We need to tell them. So we need to walk the UFO talk, and we have to exercise caution, but we have to start. It is just not working for us to only talk to ourselves. We have to reach out and talk to other people. And we have to have a sense of humor about it. Mr. John Kelly, we started a Cookies for Kelly campaign since he liked cookies so much that he thought they were more important than nuclear missiles being hovered over by UFOs. We told our readers of the blog to send him cookies at the Washington Post, and we put out the address, and people sent him cookies. And you know what? At least in the Washington Post newsroom, they talked about the possibility that these six guys who were speaking at that press conference were telling the truth, and they talked about the fact that it might have been a stupid policy to send a lifestyle reporter to make fun of them. All right? And it's a little silly, but you know what? I think it's a good idea. Because you know what? Nobody was hurt. And it's the kind of thing that just calls attention and makes the point. So sometimes you have to go silly. Sometimes you have to go, and we have to turn those to our advantage, but not with inferior product, but with product that really reaches people and says, this is a serious problem, and you need to pay attention to it. And we have to reach out with the tools that we have. Okay? And we have to reach out smartly with those tools. But mostly, this is what we have to do. You have to demand change. Thank you.